Thanks for coming, guys.
Yeah, how you doing?
I'm going to hand it over to you.
Great.
Oh, awesome.
Well, first, let me say thank you for coming out to celebrate the great innovations going on. We're very pleased to be here tonight. It's brings back memories.
It does bring back memories. In fact, it's part of our presentation. I think we actually have a photo. Holy smokes. That was from 2007.
This was quite a long time ago.
Was I ever that skinny? Were you ever that handsome?
No, but this was when we announced our technology for the first time to the world. And for those of you who heard the feedback from these great venture capitalists here, you'd appreciate the fact that it was Forrest Baskett who wandered by after our demo and came by the booth and started talking that led to us actually getting funded to build the company.
That's right. It was demo 2007. That was a lot of fun. A lot of things have happened since then. And in fact, that's why we're here tonight, is to kind of talk a little bit about where the technology is going, where this is all headed.
Where are we headed? So we're going to have the live show.
This is not our PowerPoint.
Hello, people from Demo. You might recognize me from some of my father's evil schemes. But he kind of ate something funny last night, so he's indisposed. So, I'm taking over. My father is an evil genius, but Demo fails to recognize his abilities, his style, his passion, his clarity, recognition he demands. So here's the plan. Anoint him god of Demo gods, or we will render Demo servers useless with a DOS attack of 1 million requests. A billion? Billion with a B? That seems like a lot. Is that too evil?
No.
Oh, all right. 1 billion requests!
Rick, what's going on here?
Well, this isn't our presentation, but it's okay.
Every time you go to Demo, you cause problems, Rick.
We can handle a billion.
You gotta save Demo.
We got our servers here. We can handle it, right, David?
We can handle a billion. Let's invite our anti-evil genius up, Mr. Steve Wozniak. Let's get this handled.
David?
We don't have a server, Steve. But oh, look at that! Just the power of Steve coming on stage.
Fusion fooled me again!
Yeah.
This job's harder than I thought. That's it. I quit!
Can you use that newfangled gadget of yours, Siri, to get this thing started?
Let's show him we can do it. Neil?
I could if I had my...
He's given up, but you know what? We got your back. We're going to show you right now.
Come on, Rick.
Come on, Neil.
I want to invite you back.
Right now.
But we need to save Demo.
You got it, buddy. You got it. Steve, kick it off, buddy.
Let's go. Okay. Should be going.
That's pegged. It is absolutely pegged, Neil.
1 billion.
That's hard to believe. Ladies and gentlemen, this is serious. And actually, this is a Fusion-esque. You got to admit, Neil, if we're going to do a presentation, who else is going to do it like this? I mean, when you live with the consummate practical jokers of Steve and David, you're going to end up with Mini-Me in a demo presentation.
Well done, guys.
Thank you. But you know what? In all seriousness, I wish it was bobbing more, which means we're doing over a billion IOs per second. We are right now doing, ladies and gentlemen, from a handful of servers over there, 1 billion.
1 billion.
1 billion IOPS per second. And since we're getting to the serious side, Steve, why don't we let David just give these folks, because I'm sure you have some questions, a quick explanation on how we're accomplishing 1 billion IOs per second.
You know, 30 years ago, people used tape drives, and it took seconds to find the data. Nowadays, disk drives take thousandths of a second to find the data. What we're demonstrating today is the use of non-volatile memories but as a memory device that's accessed without having to go through the operating system to access the persistence of the memory. So using non-volatile memories as the memories they are. And that allows us, as you see here in just one rack, to do over a billion IOs per second because of this memory-like access. We call this auto-commit memory, and it's a very powerful tool that we wanted to unveil to the world here, where we initially launched the company.
Thank you. So and sorry, Neil, it was just a practical joke from these guys. I promise Dr. Evil and Mini-Me is not out to get the demo servers. But if they were, that really happened. 1 billion IOs per second, and it's happening right now. In fact, if you want to walk up afterwards and corner one of these Fusion engineers, They'll pull out the screen and they'll show you. There is 1 billion IOs per second. That just happened. That's 1 billion.
Yep.
We're done, aren't we?
It's across little details. It's over 128 IO memory modules in 8 different servers running in aggregate the billion IOPS of 64-byte cache lines accesses.
Which you just sounded like our press release.
There you go.
Which just, I think, hit the wire. So if you want to read about it, it's in the press release. Are we done, sir?
Yes, we are.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for letting Fusion take the demo stage one more time.
Woo!
Awesome.
Okay, guys, stay on for a second.
All right, I
want to ask you a few questions. Can you maybe take
a seat? Yeah, that's fine.
And we'll have a conversation because I'm representing the audience here.
Okay.
And you explained it really well, but not quite well enough for me.
Okay.
to understand, because I'm a little slow on what really, you know, a billion IOPS, you know, IO operations means in the context of things, right? So what I do know is that you launched on stage, and I think a few years ago it was doing 100,000, or is it 100,000?
100,000, yeah.
And then you announced 1 million IOPS. When was that? Like last year?
We did it. Actually, the first time was with IBM in Project Quicksilver, and right. It took a rack of equipment, and it was built into their SVC, SAN Virtualization Controller.
Yeah, that was 2009, I think.
Right. And then the next year, we did it with HP, 1 million IOPS from within a single server.
Got it.
But we decided to raise the bar a little bit tonight.
So Woz, you're here too. And you're chief scientist, right?
Right.
And I heard you played a role too in terms of in shaping the product somehow. Can you talk a little bit about what your role is?
Yeah, didn't do a role like direct engineering or something like that. But as far as just, I don't know, the company culture, it starts from the beginning. And if it's going to go a long way, you know, it's sort of the ideals that you have when you start. And one of my big jobs was to recognize what was beautiful and what wasn't about the various products and the approaches of Fusion IO. And just to respect it for just a lot of different reasons. What's in that rack there, it's what just last time they were here, it would have filled this room, you know, with maybe, you know, 50 racks. So right. Maybe 100 racks, maybe right. Not even done that. And so it's just so amazing to see something. When it's done the right way, it brings things down to the simple formula that makes things small and easily obvious, you know.
So can I answer something about that, too?
Yeah.
Because, you know, Steve's not going to talk about it himself, but I remember the first engineering offsite about a month or two after he joined the company. Remember having that offsite? Yep. Steve came in right away, and he's like, okay, this is very similar to, like, some of the EEPROMs, the EEPROM, the flash technology. Have you thought about this, thought about that? And there were two key ideas right out of the gate that were making their way into patents, and it was pretty cool. I was like, wow. You know, you think that someone hasn't been in the game for a long time, and it's like, bam, he hit the ground running, and he had direct impact right out of the gate with that.
And to be fair, I'm largely here because I see the good thinking that comes up with those kind of ideas that are good because they are simple, they're direct, they see the formula a better way, and it's very out of the box sometimes. I mean, when they were up here on stage here the first time, I'm sure that almost everybody was saying, oh, this is just a worthless idea.
So I want to come back to what you first thought when you saw that, whether it was a worthless idea. But I also want to open it up to questions from the audience. They're open to a few questions. We've got a few minutes for a few questions. I do want to point out that Woz, in case you didn't know, is a co-founder of another really big company. And he's he's requesting to avoid questions about that company, if you will, and to focus on Fusion.io because this is the announcement of Fusion.io, and that's where he's involved right now. So any questions right away? We actually do have a few microphones around, so over here and over here, hands go up, and what we can get back to some more of this cool stuff. Chris.
That's pretty amazing that you got that many IOs. If you were to scale this down, my first thought is, ooh, I want this for myself. If I want to scale this down to my PC or Mac, whatever, at home, are you starting to think about deployment at that scale?
Look at that? Our primary focus as a company is in the enterprise space where the services that many of us touch every day, like Facebook and Apple, can use the technology in the cloud. But having it more directly in consumers' hands is definitely a passion because it's the companies are made up of people, and people that get to use stuff at home really appreciate it. So it has always been kind of a desire of ours to go into that market as well. Stay tuned.
You never know, but building on that, we don't think about how to shrink the home PC, but we do on a daily basis think, how do we shrink data centers? Yeah. How do we make them far more efficient?
Yeah. So on that note, can you maybe elaborate in terms of the context of this announcement? Is this more relevant, as you say, for the computing side, PC side, desktop, or is this server oriented?
It's really targeted for the enterprise and the large data centers.
Because the truth is, a single user PC is limited by the I/O bandwidth of the person interacting with it. Now, some people are doing very data intensive things like editing movies and the like. And our products have been used for post-production editing a lot of the recent major blockbuster movies because they're moving lots of data. But most people they become the bandwidth limit. But when you have the ability to provide them services that stitch together huge amounts of information up in the cloud, that's where this can really be brought to bear to reduce the footprint size of those services.
Great. Now, Woz, I wanted to get back to that question about what you first thought, because apparently they launched a demo. There were nobodies, right? They hadn't had funding. Forrest walks by and recognizes something in these companies. You also got involved really early, a few years ago. I remember the announcement.
I continually have people come up to me and make presentations like here at Demo, and I just always kind of nod my head, and this was really the most outstanding one I'd heard. I sort of, from a hardware perspective, and this was kind of a hardware starting project. It isn't what it is today, necessarily, because we're moving into the software that makes it perform well. That's really what Fusion.io is about more than anything. But they had a very different thinking about how to get these NAND flash chips into a computer in a way that was the least costly, the most efficient, the fastest operation. And also, but then I come from a business point of view. How does it compare to all the big RAID arrays, all the competitive alternatives? And they sat there and told me, oh my gosh, oh yeah, we beat an Express server, 10 to 1, and we beat this other one 20 to 1 and 5 to 1. And whoa, that's the real mark of it. It's really in the, how does it work out in the end?
Right.
Actually, bottom line.
You raise a good point. In terms of today and the competition that's out there, if you're talking about a billion IOPS, what does that mean? I mean, who are the closest competitors, and how close do they get to what you're doing?
So David, if I can, and then I want to let you drill down on the ACM piece. That's a really valid question, but what we're showing tonight in this preview is we're trying to showcase what can be done with our architecture, because there's a lot of confusion out there. Just because you put it on PCI Express card doesn't make it the same as what we're doing. And we're not opposed to inviting competitors. I mean, more people are going to expand the market faster. The problem is they're still not getting it right. They're still just taking architecture that's going through the same traditional storage block device interfaces, through the OS, through the kernel, making all these stops instead of memory.
Yeah, our biggest competition is really the status quo. And the biggest barrier is people's awareness of the impact this can have. Because you go and tell people that you can service IOs down in the millionths of a second and even faster timescales, that means that the server can do 10 times the workload. And people at first think, well, I don't have that many things that can benefit from that high a performance. What they don't necessarily realize is that performance per server is a two-sided coin. One is to get higher peak capabilities, but almost more important than that is to use fewer servers.
Got it.
Its consolidation is the flip side of the same efficiency coin.
Let me try to clarify it a little. When I first ran into it, well, this company was plugging the memory straight into the server rather than hooking it on big cables out to the normal disk RAID array structure, and it just saves steps, and that's what I appreciated. But now the rest of the world is seeing that, you know. The rest of the world's coming in. There's going to be a lot of people being able to make cards that plug into
servers. Even EMC has acknowledged that it's not going to be in the storage array anymore and talking about putting it in the server as
well.
They denied this approach at first. They denied it was right. Now they're all coming around saying this is the approach. There's going to be a lot of other people making the hardware. But how do you make the hardware perform? It's a new type of memory that really hasn't been built into the past. The status quo,
Good context. And EMC, you mentioned, is probably the closest competitor then. They're a completely different approach. Can you talk about how long it's going to take for them to get to what you're doing?
So, there's really multiple steps to what we're doing, because really it boils down to getting the data to the application as fast as possible. One thing is to get rid of the storage network, so you don't have to pay the shipping delay. The next is to get rid of the emulation of disk drives and going through RAID controllers. But actually what this is demonstrating is the final step of removing the thick layers of software, the potentially 100,000 instruction cycles worth of software to get through the operating system to have it shepherd the I.O. request to the disk. You have to get rid of all of these things. And so what we've seen from the competition is, you know, they've recognized that, yes, it goes in the server to avoid the network, and they've taken it out of the drive bays, but they're still using devices that emulate disk drives. They're just clipping them onto a card that goes in the PCI Express slot. So we're trying to show here what the full impact is of getting it accessible like a memory device.
Mm-hmm. And to be fair, whenever we were talking about our performance application acceleration, we didn't get into latency, we didn't talk about QDEPs. But companies out there were going, hey, we're just as fast. Look, we can do 1 million IOPS. We can do 2 million, 3 million. We're like, okay, well, if you want to just talk about full-out IOPS, all right, fine, we'll raise the bar. Yeah. This is what happens when you have a memory-like architecture and you're not going through disk. That is what we're demonstrating tonight to show the differentiation and answer that question.
Well, I got to say, thank you for saving demo from Mini-Me.
Of course.
There's a question back there. So, can we run a mic down there? Anyone else? Yeah,
it's an important point that it really, at the end of the day, it's not necessarily about IOPS. IOPS are a measure of performance for storage. With a memory device, you actually talk about two things, latency and bandwidth.
Exactly.
Right? And so this is our whole architecture has been designed to reduce the latency out, even the latency of the software access. And when you do that, you can reach absurd levels of performance. Yeah.
Of course, those are only stepping points to what you'd like to talk about, the generalized per user, per function that gets performed. How much does it cost?
Right, right.
That's the bottom line.
The access overhead. Yeah. Right.
We've seen a lot of announcements recently about large companies moving their data centers towards energy sources because the preponderance of energy requirements. Is there any direct relationship between the architectures you're introducing and the energy performance required of devices?
If you look today, the average processor utilization is less than 20%, which means that server is easily capable of 5 times the workload. That means to get to your total workload, you're putting in 5 times as many as you need it. And it's not just the servers. It's the networking. It's the storage. It's the software licenses. It's the people to run the whole thing and the power and such to cool it. Now, the interesting corollary to this, though, is that if you reduce the overall cost by being able to tap into the true potential of the server and making it very efficient, that doesn't mean the market shrinks. It actually means that people can now use technologies in ways that become cost-effective, and it expands the overall market. So I don't think that this will actually have an impact and roll back the clock, but it instead allows technology to be used more pervasively.
We've got time for one more question over here.
So as the assumed end user of this sequence of things that's eventually going to affect me, for the company that we're not speaking about, it was obvious what my benefit was going to be. Why should I care?
So the impact that this has is already, you guys touch it probably on a daily basis through our customers. And many of it goes unheralded because it simply makes possible the service and the quality of their service that you see.
I've watched that. Actually, I've seen people with trying to download an app, and they're like, oh, geez, this is going to take like a minute to download. Forget it. I'm not going to take that. Or a web page. It's like, oh, this web page is taking 15 seconds to load. I'm never going there again.
One of Steve's other very beneficial functions is he comes to us and says, this website is growing like crazy. And just in the – because he's always up on the newest stuff I don't even see. And he goes, but, in the last few days, because of their growth, the performance has gone gone really down. And we're like, great, go make the introduction. We're gonna get to help them out. And it's really it's really fun to see their businesses transformed in how it allows them to deal with that scaling.
So when the end user starts to demand that speed,
that's right,
that ease of use, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. Or the sophistication in the service, the fact that it needs to pull together multiple data sources, it needs to be intelligent, because we don't want to waste our times either waiting for a response or trying to filter out whether that, you know, make sense of the response. We want it to make sense of it for us. So by the time we see it, it's already compiled into something useful.
And I agree that the sophistication of the service is going to be the driving factor. But for now, there's another benefit too, which is if it's less costly for the enterprise to serve it to you, then it's, in the end, less costly for you to get.
Right. Yeah, like take Facebook. It could be 50% less than free. That's the crazy thing is a lot of these services,
they are free.
And we're seeing new services come out from different customers where it's like, before it was like, I want to put up my photos, now my videos. Now I want to be able to have live chat in a group room with just my friends and have another live chat going at the same time, and I want to pay nothing.
So what you're saying is it doesn't make it cheaper. It makes it so you don't have to have as many advertisements and other stuff in your face.
Exactly. Exactly. But the best part is it's free. And if there's any hiccup, any problem, the server goes down, it's slow, the video starts to get a little jittery. It's like, ah, geez, I can't believe this service that I'm paying nothing for isn't perfect.
Well, great. Unfortunately, guys, we're out of time. I just wanted to get this amazing announcement. Wanted to ask, when is this actually going to be ready? This is an unveiling, an announcement of something to come.
Tell you what, right? April 19th, demo spring. Ask me then.
Okay, great. Looking forward to it. Congratulations.
Oh, one last question.
Yeah. Huh? So Rick and David, thank you for joining us. I want Woz to stay here, but I wanted to ask Woz what he thought was going to be the biggest development in the next 6 months to a year.
Well, you're talking about innovation.
Innovation, roughly.
Innovation? Well, you know what? Innovation always starts with a kind of person that is an innovator, and that comes from inspiration, like when you're young, the books you read, the movies you go to, the stories you hear, the TV shows you watch. I think we have someone else in the audience that can address this very issue.
You're going to make an introduction?
I would like to introduce a hero of mine, Leonard Nimoy, a great actor.
We're out of here. Hey, see you, Steve.